the guidance note which I was talking about, guidance note 2 of Companies Act 2013. Guys, this guidance note is applicable for those companies who are under Ind AS as well as those companies who are not under Ind AS and still following the IGAAP. So since it is applicable for even those companies which are under Ind AS and we are talking about property, plant and equipment, let's try to get an idea of what this guidance note is talking about. Now, if you remember, the earlier Companies Act 1956 has prescribed minimum rates of depreciation. They have prescribed minimum rate of depreciation under Companies Act 1956. However, this minimum rate of depreciation is now not valid. You're not taking this minimum rate of depreciation as per Schedule 2. Now, what are we taking up now? We will be considering useful life of asset and its residual value. We are considering two things for taking into consideration the amount of depreciation per annum. We'll take into consideration useful life. We'll also consider its residual value to identify the depreciation to be charged per annum. Now, when we are talking about this, we need to understand that this residual life and useful life, residual value and useful life, are discussed under Section C of the schedule. Now, under the Section C, what do they even discuss about? We will park this residual value separately. Let us consider the useful life. When we are talking about useful life, what do we understand by useful life? Useful life can either be determined on the basis of the period for which you will derive the benefit or production or similar units. Now, period, when I talk about, I am referring to the number of years. Production units or similar units are basically based on number of units produced or the number of machine hours used. Can either be this way. Period is always counted in number of years, and your production units or machine hours are basically what we can determine your useful life with. So that means my depreciation can be either as per the period or can be as per production or useful life. So here we'll basically use SLM or WDV basis, while when we are talking about this method of production units, we'll use units of production method. Now, when we're talking about the period or the useful life, your Section C or your Companies Act, your Schedule 2, has given out something called as not longer than, the words being used are not longer than specified in schedule. So that means he's saying the maximum life has already been determined as per the schedule. So you have to take any period which is not longer than that period. However, in 2014, he has substituted these words and he started replaced words. It got replaced with not different from. Now, how is it different when we have replaced the words? How is it so important for him to replace these words instead of using not different from, instead of using not longer than, if he is using not different from, not different from? Is different from. Why did he change it? Let's try to understand. If the schedule has given that a particular property, plant and equipment has to be or if the useful life is not longer than 10 years, that means an enterprise can take a period shorter than 10 years and still complying with the schedule. However, if I have substituted the word with not different from, and if the schedule is saying 10 years, a period shorter than 10 years will also be considered as non-compliance with the schedule. So, non-compliance is not a crime. All that you have to do is, you need to give an additional disclosure. You have to give an extra disclosure saying that, boss, this particular asset, I haven't taken the years or useful life given in schedule 2, but I have given a specific different useful life. Now, if you look at the schedule, they have actually named two different types of assets. One is called as no extra shift depreciation or continuous processing plants. No extra shift depreciation. They are called as NESD assets. No extra shift depreciation or continuous processing plants, CPP. Now, these are two types of assets which he is talking about. And other than these, he has a separate schedule to be prepared. Now, what are these assets and what? How do we actually give a disclosure regarding each of them? I'm not going to discuss what is the number of useful life which is given as per schedule, because that is too long for someone to really buy heart. So let us only understand to what extent are the disclosures required if you are following the schedule or if you are not following the schedule for these particular assets. So I'm saying I will divide the assets into two types. One is CPP or NESD assets. Other one is other than non-NESD assets. So these are the two classifications for which we have to discuss the disclosures about. Let's see what they are. Yes, guys. So we were discussing about the Part C and I told you the Schedule 2 will divide the PPE or the assets into two types. One is called as CPP or NESD assets. Other one is called as non-NESD assets. What is the CPP or NESD? CPP is continuous processing plants. NESD is no extra shift depreciation. Now, whenever we are talking about no extra shift depreciation assets or continuous processing plants, remember that there is no shifts in this. But when we're talking about non-NESD assets, we can talk about three things. One is single shift. Double shift or a triple shift. If an asset is going for a single shift basis of depreciation, then in such case, no extra disclosure necessary. But if you are going for a double shift or if you are going for a triple shift, then there is a compulsion that you have to give disclosures. Then if I am talking about the CPP assets, that is continuous processing plant assets, then you will have to give disclosures for this as well. Now, whenever I go for a double shift or a triple shift, then there is a different useful life that we actually determine, because we try to determine the useful life based on their number of shifts being used. An asset can have a useful life of 10 years if it is used on one shift basis. Each shift is normally calculated as 8 hours, including the layoff time. But sometimes there could be a situation where the asset might be used for a much more period or a longer period than just 8 hours, a double shift. A triple shift sometimes can happen. Whenever there's a double shift or a triple shift working which happens, then the useful life will not be considered as 10 years. It will become much shorter than 10 years because you are over-utilizing that particular asset. So that's why we'll always have a different logic. And what are the CPP assets? Continuous processing plants. These are called as CPPs. Now, when we basically look at the CPP, then what is it different or how do we define this? When I look at a CPP, CPP can be said that it has technical and requirement for continuous processing . It should be technically feasible. At the same time, there's a requirement for you to do continuous processing. This word continuous processing is meant as substantially, it has a high startup or shutdown cost. What is a startup or shutdown cost? Normally, when I start a particular asset, there's a particular amount of expenditure which is incurred. Let's say I'm talking about a galvanizing plant. Galvanizing plant means basically there's a sheet of metal and there's a zinc which is boiling, and that sheet of metal is dipped into the zinc tub. So automatically the zinc gets coated on the metal and it is making it anti-rust. Now, whenever you do this, the zinc which is there in the tub should be maintained at a particular temperature level for the galvanizing process to happen. Now, to bring it up to that particular temperature level, we have to spend at least 24 to 36 hours to bring that particular asset or to bring the zinc to that particular level of boiling plant. So that means if I shut down the galvanizing plant, then when I want to intend to start it, it will take me at least a day and a half to bring it into operational condition. Now, throughout that period, there is a substantial startup cost which is being incurred. That is the reason why we say that they are called as continuous processing plants. Such continuous processing plants normally have a high startup or a shutdown cost. Now, whenever we have a CPP asset, we'll always have to make sure that there is a separate identification within the schedule for defining what is a useful life. Any period other than that can be considered, but you need to give sufficient disclosures for that. Remember, guys, if I take other than Schedule 2 rates or Schedule 2 useful lives, if I take a period other than Schedule 2 useful life, then in such cases, you need to give a justification along with a technical data to support the claim. You're claiming that my useful life is different from what is there in Schedule 2. So I just don't need a justification. I also need to have a technical data which will substantiate that particular claim. Both combined should be disclosed. Then only I will say that I can take a rate other than what is given under Schedule 2. Got it? So I'll just brief up what is NESD. NESD stands for no extra shift depreciation. That is NESD assets. Now, whenever some asset is going for a double shift or a triple shift, sometimes it is possible for me to identify at the beginning of the year itself that this is going for a double shift or a triple shift, based on which I will determine what is its useful life. But sometimes there could very well be a situation where I might have decided that this particular asset is a single shift asset, but instead I'm using it on a double shift basis, or I'm using it on a triple shift basis. So initially I've decided the useful life, or I've estimated the useful life based on single shift basis. Subsequently, there is a change. Then what will be the depreciation for such asset which was initially assessed as single shift, but later on during the year has been used under double shift or triple shift basis? Remember, guys, if I have assessed as per single shift and I'm using it now on a double shift basis, then I'll have to charge an extra depreciation of 50% of the entire depreciation charge on the single shift. Or if I'm using under triple shift, then I'll have to add an extra depreciation of 100%. So what am I saying? If initially I've decided that that particular asset is single shift, but subsequently during the year I have gone for a double shift basis, then in such case such double shift assets should be depreciated to be charged to P&L will be 50% more than what you charge on single shift basis. Same way, if an asset is assessed as single shift basis at the beginning of the year, but subsequently during the year I have used the triple shift depreciation or triple shift basis for production, then the depreciation to be charged to P&L will be 100% more than what is there in the single shift. That means the depreciation charge will be exactly 2 times of what we charge under single shift basis. Got it? So this is in sense what we can talk about. So I'll just put it as into 1.5 into 2. This is the depreciation what we charge. From a single shift basis to a double shift, it will be 1.5. From a single shift basis to a triple shift, it will be into 2. This is the depreciation that I will charge when I'm talking about an asset. We'll have to look at the useful life. We'll have to look at what is the residual value in this case. Let's see what is the residual value which is defined as per the Schedule 2. And what if I decide to take a different residual value than what is given under Schedule 2? So let's start looking at residual value as per Schedule 2. When we discuss about residual value, what Schedule 2 has prescribed as per as Schedule 2, as per as residual value is concerned, is that the residual value should be not more than 5% of original cost of asset. Again, the words not more than have been substituted, and now we start using the terminology like we have used in the case of useful life, not different from. We'll start using the words not different from. So by this, what do we understand? Sufficient disclosures are necessary if, number one, residual value is less than 5% of original cost, or it is also necessary if the residual value is more than 5% of original cost. That is why he has used the word not different from. Had I used the word not more than, then if the residual value is less than 5%, then I need not give a disclosure. But since he has substituted the word, these words are no longer making sense. He used the word not different from. So either it is more or less, I'll have to make sure that I'm giving sufficient disclosure. Same is the case even with useful life. Got it? So there is no particular form of depreciation that he is talking about, saying use any method, and he has stipulated useful lives based on 2 types of assets, CPP and NESD assets and non-NESD assets. Residual value, single logic he has applied, not more than 5% was the initial wordings, but now he has substituted saying that not different from 5% of its original cost. Got it? So this in essence is just a short summary of what the Schedule 2 is talking about. I'm not getting too much of depth. If I gone into that depth, I would have given you what are the number of years in which you will start depreciating the assets. We're not getting into that. We are only looking at the treatment, what is given in Schedule 2, to what extent it is relevant for us to apply it with Ind AS 16. So that's it, guys. As far as your Ind AS 16 is concerned, there are ITFGs which are coming, and there will be more ITFGs which will be coming, which will be updated as they keep coming out of ICAI.